they said some of these mounds that they build get up to 7 meters high. That's as high as our house.
So we're talking in the old money, what, 20, more than 25 feet?
Yeah. Incredible sizes of those there. But one of the funny things, and the reason that I wanted to talk about it is, termites don't like dry air. So that's why their cells or their mounds are always sealed. In fact, you never see a termite walking around in the open air. They're always in sealed areas. And the reason is that their bodies just can't stand desiccation. And what happens is that when the first rains, first heavy rains come, this is when the termites, the winged ones, leave the mound and off they go and start off new colonies.
So are they about to do that now? You're in the west?
That is what's happening now in the many of the big mounds and wherever they're living. They're getting ready for when the first rains come. And of course, guess what the dragonflies do? They have their last meal, last good meals before winter comes, because as most people don't know, during winter, you never see a dragonfly.
Where do they go?
They're dead.
Dead?
They're all run out of food.
All right.
See, they have to catch food in the air.
Yep.
And that's why during the winter time, our rainbow birds and our swallows here leave here, because there's nothing in the air here for them to catch. They've got to catch their food in the air. So they have to migrate to the north. And so your rainbow bee eaters, your swallows, all head north. And up at Geraldton and Carnarvon, there's plenty of stuff flying around because it's not as wet. The insects are up there, whereas down here they're not here. But it's the termites, the winged termites, which I've seen magpies flying out and catching them. One of the things I couldn't believe, I actually saw one of the hawks flying along and actually catching termites in the air with their feet and then eating them while they're still flying.
Incredible. Now, tell us about this magnetic termite, Eric.
Yes, up in the Kimberley, there's a group of termites up there called Amy Termes meridionalis. That's the scientific name for them. They build a mound, which is fairly common with a lot of them, but they do an incredible thing. They build a mound that goes up straight up into the air, but it's flat. Instead of being sort of circular, this is flat, and it's oriented north and south. So at certain times of the day, on one side on the ground, there's this huge shadow. At midday, no shadow at all.
Incredible.
That is a most unusual. Amy Termes, that's the biggest, I think, family. I think it's got about 50 members. Australia, strangely, has just over 180 species of termites. I didn't know that. It's quite a lot.
It certainly is. The ones that attack your house, are they of a particular type?
There's several of them that attack houses, and this is where your termite people who come around and do their inspections of logs, etc. There are several of them. Oh, and something that a lot of people don't know, if you get a little baby termite that's just hatched out of the egg, and you have a look to see what all the other termites are eating, and you give that your little baby termite the food that the others are eating, in 2 days your baby's dead.
True.
Yeah. Oh. And in fact, a lot of people don't know, as soon as a baby termite hatches out of the egg, one of its siblings comes along and says, "Oh, you've hatched, have you? Oh, yes, what do I eat? Oh, hang on. Open your mouth," and the baby has to open his mouth, and one of the siblings, and they vomit up some of their gut content.
That's a beautiful sound.
Give it to the baby, and they say, "Now you can go and eat." Because what happens, termites can chew up and bite and swallow the thing, but their stomach can't digest the wood. And so they have to get into their stomach bacteria who can dissolve the wood. And so the siblings, as soon as the baby hatches, open up, give them a sample, "Now you can go and eat." The baby eats, and of course the bacteria break down
quickly. Sue has called to say that she used to go into the bush around 2J with the termite mounds there, take the top off the mound, harvest the section between the base and the top, then put the top back on the mound to preserve it, then put the harvested centrepiece into a 44-gallon drum, put some damp paper or old carpet on top and around the inside edge of the drum, put axle grease to prevent the termites from escaping, and they'd use it for finches. They'd feed for weeks from it.
Oh, right.
Yes,
well, finches, although strangely finches basically seed eaters. There's quite a lot of meat eating going on with quite a lot of birds. A lot of people don't know that some of our black cockatoos, would you believe, go to tree trunks where they can actually hear beetle larvae inside the tree trunks, and they actually pull the wood off there, grab the caterpillar and eat it.
Apparently they're quite good at repairing them now once if there's damage.
Oh yes, in fact that because termites hate being dry, if there's any breakage in the ceiling of the humidity inside the mound, there's alarm bells ring and then everyone comes along and seals it up. And a lot of people don't know, isn't it strange how the termite mound is made out of the soil that's there, but when it rains, it does get washed away?
No.
And apparently what they do when they are making their mound, they actually mix it up with something in their saliva. And this saliva actually turns it into cement.
And they waterproof.
And you've probably heard of people up in the Pilbara or in the north areas where there are these big termite mounds. They actually, when they want to make their tennis courts in their backyard, they crush up the termite mound material, wet it down, roll it onto there, and it's literally like cement.
Eric, you are a national living treasure. Thank you so much for your time today.
My pleasure, Ian. Catch up.
See you later. Eric McCrum here on 720 ABC Perth 25.
Well, there you go. I just want to add, flubs eats termites too.